Hey, I'm Zack Semke, director of Passive House Accelerator, and I'm super excited to share putting the punk into Passive House with you. So thanks for watching. In this video, I'll be sharing stories about the climate crisis, climate action, and the role of buildings in all of it. So the first story we need to start with to ground that conversation is, what is the climate science telling us? And there's no better place to start than this image of the sunrise as seen from the International Space Station. That thin blue line you see arcing across our screen is the atmosphere. Now, when we go outside and look up at the sky, it looks really big, so we assume that the atmosphere is also really big. But if the Earth were an apple, the atmosphere is as thin as the skin on that apple, yet we're dumping over 110 million tons of carbon pollution into that very thin, life-sustaining layer every day. And that's having a big impact. This brilliant infographic from the climate scientist and communicator Ed Hawkins tells the story. Hawkins is the guy who created the colored warming stripes that we see everywhere now in climate communications, with the ever darker red stripes showing how far above normal our temperatures are climbing. The rising curve you see is the Keeling curve, or the rising concentrations of CO2 in our atmosphere. They just hit a record 420 parts per million a couple weeks ago. I'm recording this in May of 2022. The labeled dots show the various climate accords and agreements that have been made over the decades. And the message is clear: we aren't moving fast enough. The Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, or IPCC, has been doing a bunch of work in the past couple of years to gather the latest scientific insights and to tell us what the implications are for various degrees of warming. Today, we are at 1.1 degrees Celsius of warming, probably closer to 1.2 degrees. If we succeed at limiting warming to 1.5 degrees, then the hottest day, the likelihood of severe drought, the increase in rainfall, the decrease in snow cover, and the likelihood of intense hurricanes and typhoons still all get worse incrementally. If we limit warming to 2 degrees Celsius, then all of that gets significantly worse. And if, God forbid, we hit 4 degrees, then things really do look apocalyptic. Here's another look from IPCC, this time featuring the ember bar graphs from the 1.5 degree report. Yellow means moderate risk, red high risk, and purple very high risk. At 1.1 degrees Celsius warming today, we are already at moderate risk category across the board. At 1.5 degrees, we hit high risk for unique and threatened systems and extreme weather events. And at 2 degrees, we're already at very high risk for that first category and basically high risk across the board. This chart goes into more detail, showing that warm water corals, small-scale low-latitude fisheries, the Arctic region, and coastal flooding are in big trouble. And if we go past 2 degrees warming, then everything gets way worse. And we're already feeling the impacts of climate change. This image shows recent flooding in New York. Here's the subway system in New York City being overwhelmed by floodwaters. We've had massive wildfires across the Southwest, West, and Pacific Northwest. We're also experiencing crazy spikes in temperatures, like the heat dome that brought temperatures in Oregon, Washington, and British Columbia into uncharted, hellish territory for several days. In March of 2022, temperatures in the Antarctic spiked 68 degrees Fahrenheit above normal, the largest temperature anomaly recorded, apparently. The science is also telling us that the window for action is closing fast. So far, we've emitted 2,475 gigatons of CO2. To have a 50% likelihood of keeping warming to 1.5 degrees, we have a carbon budget of just 420 gigatons left to emit. To keep warming to 1.7 degrees, 770 gigatons. To keep warming to 2 degrees, 1,270 gigatons of CO2. But remember that over half of all anthropogenic CO2 emissions were emitted in the last 30 years, so those gigatons are going to go really fast. Time is of the essence here. Climate scientists are telling us that we've entered the decisive decade. To keep warming to 1.5 degrees Celsius, we need to cut annual emissions in half by 2030. The good news is that inspiring youth climate activism has raised both awareness and alarm about the climate crisis to higher levels than ever. Here's Greta Thunberg in front of the Swedish parliamentary building a few years ago. And here she is just a year later at the Montreal Climate March, speaking in front of hundreds of thousands. And while Greta has become the poster child of the youth climate movement, the movement is also led by youth activists of color from around the world and also North America. Still, we face headwinds. As Catherine Hayhoe points out here, we face five types of climate denial. The first is, it's not real, so classic climate denialism, and that's becoming less common. The second is, it's not us. Maybe the sun is causing warming, for example. The third, it's not bad. Hey, warmer winters in North Dakota would be great. The fourth, we can't fix it and here's why. So for example, actually the Jevons paradox says that energy efficiency backfires because people will just use more energy because it's cheaper. Or actually renewable energy isn't feasible because it's too expensive and uses too many rare earth elements. Or actually electric vehicles are a bad idea because they pollute more than internal combustion engine vehicles do. Now, none of these arguments are true, but they are common. And finally, the fifth form of denialism, it's too late. I want to spend a couple minutes pushing back on this one because it's really problematic. So, the doomer story, we're screwed. Roger Hallam, co-founder of Extinction Rebellion, is one of the world's most prominent doomers. He has since been disavowed by Extinction Rebellion after making comments that seemed to downplay the Holocaust. So to be clear, my critique here is not aimed at Extinction Rebellion, but rather at Hallam. But anyway, he recently said this of climate change in an interview with BBC News. I'm talking about the slaughter, death, and starvation of 6 billion people this century, he says. That's what the science predicts. Only it's not what the science predicts. Climate Feedback is a website that fact-checks climate claims. Most of their work has been spent countering climate denialism, but increasingly they're having to deal with doomist claims like Hallam's. As you can see, their verdict here is that Hallam's claim is incorrect, unsupported by published research, and that while the climate crisis will have serious consequences, published studies have not predicted 6 billion human deaths this century, and there's no credible mechanism referred to that would justify how this could happen. Hallam's BBC interview was tame compared to what he says in this video, advice to young people as they face annihilation, which has been viewed tens of thousands of times. Hallam says, what it's about is mental collapse, the loss of all your dreams, and being dragged off to be slaughtered in war. It's about being brutalized. It's about rape and slow starvation, ending in early death for the thousands of millions of young people around the world today. If you don't feel the terror and horror of what it is to come now, then you soon will. And then you will feel the rage, the hatred, and then despair. This is Hallam's call to rebellion. It's also irresponsible, and it's certainly not scientific. Of course, there are more palatable and socially acceptable versions of doomerism out there. Here's one from America's novelist, Jonathan Franzen, who seems to love dropping what he sees as truth bombs like this one. We literally are living in end times for civilization as we know it, he says. We are long past the point of averting climate catastrophe. And if your Twitter feed is anything like mine, hopefully it isn't, then you see messages like this all the time. The human species is just 40 to 80 years away from total extinction, and the world is completely oblivious. I guess you've got to admire his certitude here. Now, it's perfectly normal and okay to be freaked out by climate change, to be worried about its effects, and to mourn what we've already lost and what we're sure to lose in the future. There's no sugarcoating it. This is tough stuff. But when I see this doomerist framing, I can't help but think about the cognitive distortions found in clinical depression. One of the most effective forms of treatment of depression is called cognitive behavioral therapy, and it identifies several cognitive distortions of the depressed mind and provides tools to push back on those distortions. Three of the most common are emotional reasoning, or I feel hopeless, so there must be no hope, and all or nothing thinking, or if we exceed 2 degrees Celsius, then we have totally failed and it's game over for the human species, and catastrophizing. If I can envision a scary future, then that must be where we're headed. If I can imagine 6 billion people dying this century due to climate change, then that's where we must be headed. Michael Mann, the climate scientist and author of the book, The Climate Wars, says, doomist men are dead wrong. Our demise is only assured if we follow their lead and surrender. If your midlife crisis has caused you to give up on the future, then step aside. But all this doomism is impacting our collective mental health, and I would argue our ability to be creative and constructive in addressing the very real crisis that we face. And that's particularly true for young people. Alina Wood, a climate scientist and communicator who is active on TikTok sharing climate science, as well as pushing back on doomism, shares the top five questions that she gets asked by the young people that she interacts with on TikTok. One, is it too late? Two, should I go to college or will the world end by then? Three, am I a bad person for having a child? Four, will we run out of food and water soon? And five, how can I help as an individual with no power? And here's a taste of the kind of despair that kids are sharing on TikTok. This video is going to be my declaration of giving up. I've been getting so many videos about climate change, and I've been crying and shaking for the past 3 hours. I'm going to stop caring because we might not even be alive in the next couple of years. You guys, we're failing the kids here, and it's having a real impact on people's lives. And you know that this climate despair must be contributing to the rapid rise in sadness and hopelessness among youth that The Atlantic recently reported on. Interestingly, as Sarah Ray writes in Scientific American, climate anxiety is an overwhelmingly white phenomenon. Ray observes that people of color have been dealing with the existential threat of racism for generations and have built up traditions of resilience over those generations. Maybe climate change is the first time many of us white people have faced an existential threat, and we probably have something to learn from those traditions of resilience in communities of color. Which brings me to my next story, and I bet that many of you share a similar one, and that's that my family is my story. Here they are, my wife Anne, my daughter who just turned 16, and my two boys age 11 and 9. Our kids are beautiful and silly and creative and vulnerable, because we're all vulnerable. As a father, I want them to know the facts about the climate crisis and also the solutions. I want to foster strength and resilience in them so they can thrive this century, because I do think they can thrive and that we all can thrive. And I've got some stories to share that explain why I think that. So to hear those stories, please check out part two of Putting the Punk into Passive House. To learn more about Passive House, please subscribe to our YouTube channel, visit passivehouseaccelerator.com, and join in at our Passive House Accelerator Live Zoom calls on Wednesdays. Thanks for watching.